Clone Time, September 10th, 1970. In the yoga of knowledge, in orientation through the assimilation of an appropriate philosophy is of premier importance. This is not so much the case with respect to the yogas of action and of love. And in fact, in the latter case, since the principle of feeling is of predominant importance, there may be even a considerable neglect of any philosophical orientation, the action and preparation being more devotional and perhaps even ritualistic in its nature. And a way of action, a discipline in action, may have a much greater importance in the case of the yoga of action or will than a philosophical background. But in the case of the yoga of knowledge, it is very important. Such an orientation is supplied by the philosophy of Shankara. We will not enter into this at length, but develop simply its most important governing principle. This affirmed principle is to the effect that all in the world of phenomena is simply a maya, in other words, an illusion. If man dissolves the illusion, he then finds that the reality is Brahman, to use the Indian term, which would be somewhat similar to our conception in the form that would be the reality is God and none other than God. However, there is a difference in what we mean by God as compared to the conception of Brahman, and the latter conception being considerably more philosophical, more intertwined into the very necessity of things, more fundamental, in fact. It is a better term. To realize that all things are Brahman is to find a universal friendliness in the environment.
The goal of this yoga is the realization, I am Atman. The Atman is that which persists from life to life. It also is true that the Atman is one and not many. I do not have an individual Atman. I, the Atman, have an instrument through which I function. And in the development within the total meaning of the Atman, it appears and is realized that the apparently individual Atman is but a projection or reflection of the universal Atman, so that the realization contains the meaning. The Atman is identical with the Param Atman. It also is in the literature that this state is identical with moksha or nirvana. And so we have this fact that one has attained the right to enter finally into the state of nirvana. This is not fully consummated ordinarily until the death of the last gross vehicle. Then there can be a departure, at least for a great age, from the world of action or the samsara. But this is not the final word of yoga. There is also the possibility that inasmuch as the individual who has departed from samsara can no longer be a force for good within the universe of action, it is possible to renounce the permanent enjoyment at this time of the state of nirvana. And that will lead then to what I have called a more advanced yoga in the form of the yoga of the renunciation, or the yoga of the great renunciation. At this stage of the great liberation, one has attained not only to a state of inconceivable delight, a delight which is not simply a minor euphoria, but a delight which is a great force of purification. A delight that gives one the feeling that he is resting upon sacred or holy ground. But in addition to that, he finds now the answers to the great metaphysical questions that have worried him perhaps throughout his life. Some of the questions vanish because they no longer have meaning. But take the three that are so famous, namely the question of God, of freedom, and of immortality. The answers are positive. He first learned that whatever you may call the secret heart of all that is, it is a friend, and that it is most precious indeed. Call it God, or call it Parabrahma, or call it Adi Buddha. It does not matter at all. It is a friend, indeed, the great friend. And furthermore, as to immortality, one now knows that consciousness never ends. And immortality does not mean the persistence of an instrument of action or the instrument of specific forms of cognition, but a persistence of consciousness. The consciousness may change its form, but consciousness is eternal, and one knows this. And as to freedom, for the first time, he knows real freedom. Not simply that narrow conception of freedom, namely as doing as one pleases, for this is not truly freedom. It is a bondage to one's desires, and one becomes the servant or slave of what it pleases him to do. But it is that larger freedom that can lead to a choice on the basis of will, not on the basis of a personal desire. One has the freedom of true command. The answer to these questions thus is positive, though in a form that cannot be communicated to others with the certainty it brings to the sadhaka himself. So now, having arrived at this place of security and delight and vast assurance, the great goal of this yoga is achieved. Beyond lie other courses, and these we will consider in a later discourse.